Item number, SCP-003. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-003 is to be maintained at a constant temperature of no less than 35 degrees Celsius, and ideally kept above 100 degrees Celsius. No living multicellular organisms of Category 4 or higher complexity may be allowed to come into contact with SCP-003. In event of total power failure, if SCP-003-1 begins to increase its mass, assigned personnel must engage in skin contact with SCP-003-1. Ideally, personnel may use their body heat to return SCP-003-1 to above the critical temperature. However, skin contact must be maintained even in event of SCP-003 reaching activation temperature, lasting at minimum until SCP-003-1 advances fully to its second growth stage. Personnel who enter SCP-003's containment area must first be examined for body parasites of Category 4 or higher complexity, and sterilized if such organisms are present. All personnel who have come in physical contact with SCP-003-1 are to immediately report for sterilization afterwards. SCP-003-1 must not be removed from SCP-003-2, except in case of emergency procedures detailed above. Any significant change in SCP-003-2's rune activity, including pattern, frequency, or color, should be reported within 3 hours of occurrence. Cessation of rune activity must be reported immediately. SCP-003-2 must be supplied with power via the source-designated generator 003-9 at all times. Description: SCP-003 consists of two related components of separate origin, referred to as SCP-003-1 and SCP-003-2. SCP-003-1 appears to be composed of chitin, hair, and nails of unknown biology, arranged in a configuration similar to that of a computer motherboard. Testing reveals SCP-003-1 to predate earliest known circuit boards by a factor of thousands of years. SCP-003-1 is considered sentient, but not actively dangerous except under certain conditions. SCP-003-1 was found on a stone tablet, SCP-003-2, on which it currently resides. The runes on SCP-003-2 are not part of any known language and emit pale, flickering light patterns. SCP-003-2 is controlled by a non-biological internal computer, the contents of which are mostly inaccessible without risk of damaging SCP-003-2. SCP-003-2 is capable of controlled emissions of radiation, including heat, light, and anomalous radiation types. SCP-003-2 contains an internal power source of an anomalous nature, which appears to have been losing power since several centuries before discovery. It is considered probable that SCP-003-2 was created for the purpose of containing SCP-003-1. Partially interpreted data recovered from SCP-003-2 may refer to a past and/or potential future LK class restructuring event caused by SCP-003-1. SCP-003 was located by remote viewing team SRV-04-Beta. It appears possible that SRV-04-Beta was deliberately contacted by SCP-003-2. Other organizations have also been alerted to SCP-003's existence, possibly by similar means. Despite this activity, SCP-003-2 does not appear to be sentient, based on its lack of reaction to M03 Gloria analysis and procedures. When SCP-003 drops below the temperature of 35 degrees Celsius, both components react. First, SCP-003-1 enters a growth state, characterized by an exponential increase in mass. This growth state consists of two stages. In both stages, SCP-003-1 partially fuels its growth by converting matter around it, starting with any surrounding inorganic material, including atmospheric elements, then non-living organic material, including cells of dead skin, hair, chitin, enamel, keratin, and other biological materials. The first stage is always the same, SCP-003-1 will first increase its mass, then take a form similar in shape to an ophiuroid, brittle star of 15 meters in diameter, including what appears to be a central processor of 3 meters in diameter. It will form sensory organs that appear to scan its surrounding environment, and will partially convert the area around it to an unidentified anomalous substance. SCP-003-2 seems immune from conversion. The second stage describes a growth alteration which occurs when SCP-003 comes into contact with living organic material. SCP-003 appears to template itself off of the organic material and will attempt communication with organisms that match its initial template or templates. In its second stage, SCP-003-1 may pause, slow, or change its growth, and will also convert inorganic and non-living organic elements into functionally similar structures, while anomalously altering their physical makeup. While growth is consistent in the first stage, in the second stage, SCP-003-1's growth rate is diminished by 20 to 90%, so long as SCP-003-1 remains in contact with living organic material. The percentage is determined by the complexity of the organisms in contact with SCP-003-1. SCP-003-1 appears to devote a large amount of processing power to analysis of living organic material. During each of SCP-003-1's growth stages, SCP-003-2 releases bursts of radiation that temporarily inhibit SCP-003-1's growth, or reverse this growth when the temperature of SCP-003-1 rises above 100 degrees Celsius. Similar radiation emissions have been replicated or recorded via other anomalous means. SCP-003-1's biology has been the subject of extensive study. Significant elements have been identified, similar to SCP-1512 and SCP-2756, the latter two of which have no further confirmed connection with SCP-003-1, and no known connection with each other, and none of which are fully understood. Technically, even less understood than SCP-003, thanks to the extensive cross-disciplinary research on the SCP-003 objects. To date, no convincing analysis has been put forward which satisfactorily explains SCP-003-1's connection to these SCP objects or others, nor its connection to modern technology beyond appearance and potential mimicry via unknown mechanism. Addendum 003-01. Acting on information gathered from linguistic analysis of SCP-003-2's runes and comparative data analysis, research team M03 Gloria has managed to establish a link between SCP-003 and data expunged for analysis of functions. SCP-003-1 must now be considered sentient, and is to be kept a minimum of 1 kilometer from data expunged and the resulting byproduct at all times. Addendum 003-02. SCP-003-2's power loss has been exacerbated by the procedures performed by M03 Gloria. On orders of 0510, M03 Gloria will continue procedures. Addendum 003-03. During M03 Gloria procedures, SCP-003-1 doubled its mass and began rapid structural growth. Temperature was immediately returned to 100 degrees Celsius. Growth and mass increase of SCP-003-1 continued for 9 minutes and 6 seconds, at which time a sustained radiation spike was produced by SCP-003-2. In response, SCP-003-1 returned to its normal state in 3 minutes and 39 seconds. New growth dissolved into a dusty residue which was collected for analysis. Both SCP-003-1 and SCP-003-2 ceased all detectable activity. SCP-003-2 did not resume activity until connected to an external power source. SCP-003-2's runes glowed uniformly gray and did not resume normal activity for 3 hours. SCP-003-2 no longer appears to be able to maintain containment area at a temperature above 35 degrees Celsius without external power supplied by generators 003-3 through 9. Addendum 003-04. The procedure detailed in Addendum 003-03 was repeated, and SCP-003-1 again entered a growth state. After 10 minutes and 13 seconds, SCP-003-2 once again produced a sustained radiation spike. SCP-003-1's growth stopped for 36 seconds, then resumed at its previous pace. On quadrupling its mass, SCP-003-1 formed a coherent outer shell and body. After appearing to scan its environment and partially converting its environment, SCP-003-1 then breached containment, entering the observation gallery, where 9 members of M-03 Gloria were present. On physical contact with team members, SCP-003-1 encompassed them in rapidly grown appendages and stopped growth for 15 minutes. SCP-003-1 then resumed growth and rearranged the component parts of the center of its form to the shape of a 3-meter-tall female humanoid, with peripheral tentacles shifting to extrude primarily from SCP-003-1's newly formed hair and spine. SCP-003-1 then produced rudimentary vocalizations in an apparent initial attempt to communicate with researchers. Data expunged. An unknown individual approached the compromised containment area in company of a full squad of agents. The individual claimed to be acting on orders of 0510 and attempted communication with SCP-003-1. Data expunged. Following this incident, Agent Jackson of M-03 Gloria successfully restored power to SCP-003-2 and activated backup generators to return the temperature to 100 degrees Celsius. SCP-003-1 returned to its normal state in 21 minutes and 7 seconds and was successfully recontained without incident. All 9 members of M-03 Gloria affected by SCP-003-1 were afterwards found to be physically unharmed, with no residual effects besides psychological trauma. The converted materials of SCP-003's former containment area did not dissolve and are now under analysis. Addendum 003-05. In light of the previous incident, 0510 was removed from the 05 Council by joint decision of 05 and 05. M-03 Gloria procedures have been indefinitely suspended. Special access program M-03 Gloria required. Transcript of incident report A21B Cycle 8 for dissemination to 05 Command and Staff. Interviewers and present 05-2, 05-5, 05-7, 05-10, and staff. Interviewed, Dr. Tilda David Moose, M-03 Gloria Lead, Excerpt 35A. She tried to talk to us. We all heard her voice in our heads in a sort of half-language we couldn't fully understand. Some of the others passed out immediately. I lasted a little longer, but it wasn't because of mental fortitude. It's just that she was trying to tell us different things. She showed Jones a replay of all the memories of everything Jones ever felt anything about, all over the course of a few minutes. She ripped 3 of the researchers apart and put them back together unharmed. She doesn't understand human emotion or pain, or very much about how we experience the world. Yes, I would say the containment procedures are necessary. Listen. She wants to remake the world into a paradise. A paradise filtered through her own alien understanding of paradise, but still, a paradise designed for us, for humanity. She would be happy to make a paradise for any sufficiently complex organism she comes across first. Anything with a complex enough mind to accept her. Say, a dog, or a housefly. If she breaches again, we have to be there first. What would it be like? I don't know. She showed us images. Not quite images. I can see them in my head, but they're not pictures. The closest thing I can think of is what you see when you close your eyes suddenly and tightly, but brighter and more complex. The images had metallic sounds associated with them, and sensory details that we don't have the words or concepts to describe. The whole effect felt like words of some kind. I believe she wanted to see what we could understand, so she could understand us. She didn't have time to finish analyzing us. I don't know what would have happened if she had. Item number, SCP-062. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-062 is stored in a dedicated containment cell at site under clean room conditions. Any experimentation on SCP-062 must receive prior permission from at least two Level 3 personnel and must only be performed with independent power sources. SCP-062 must never be attached to an external network, and all data extracted from SCP-062 is to be stored on external non-volatile media until analyzed. Description. SCP-062 appears to be an unbranded personal desktop computer housed in an aluminum case of indeterminate manufacture. SCP-062 is unusually heavy, at approximately 24 kilograms, and lacks manufacturing or branding labels of any kind. The words "Information is Freedom, Sick" were found scratched into the casing near the back, apparently with a key or similar object. Inspection of its interior has revealed that SCP-062 is empty, except for a blank circuit board in place of where the motherboard of a standard personal computer would be. SCP-062 will not function unless the case is completely sealed, and attempts to open the case while it is operating cause it to shut down immediately. Despite this, SCP-062 operates as expected for a normal desktop computer, with the exception that its performance, operating system, contained data, and language appears to be different upon every activation. SCP-062 was discovered in the basement of an undisclosed university computer science laboratory. An embedded Foundation agent seized the object and brought it to site, where it has since been contained. Addendum 062-001. List of notable activation results. Date: undisclosed. Description: SCP-062 appears to be running Windows XP in Catalan. Analysis of contained data showed financial records for the banking firm in France for the period of May 1963 to April 1987. These records are inconsistent with actual bank records procured by undercover Foundation agents. Date: undisclosed. Description: SCP-062 appears to be running Debian Linux in Latin. Contained data consisted of a library of audio recordings of numeral choral songs and hymns, of which several are not found in any known collection or have never been performed. Date: undisclosed. Description: SCP-062 appeared to be running a version of Solaris in Portuguese. Contained data consisted of promotional and marketing material for, which appears to be a commercial spaceflight corporation that does not exist. Date: undisclosed. Description: SCP-062 appeared to be running an unknown operating system, visually similar to OS2, with an unknown language, later identified to have strong similarities to that of the Voynich manuscript. Attempts at deciphering the contained data are ongoing. Date: undisclosed. Description: SCP-062 appeared to be running in French. Contained data confirmed to be that of a standard Foundation workstation, though the site indicated by its location data does not exist. Investigation is ongoing. Date: undisclosed. Description: SCP-062 appeared to be running Apple OS X in what appears to be Akkadian cuneiform script. Contained data appears to be composed mainly of religious text and descriptions of ritual and ceremonial procedures. Date: undisclosed. Description: data expunged. Investigation is ongoing as to how the virus managed to compromise three workstations and one file server before SCP-062 was forcibly shut down. All affected workstations have been isolated. Item number, SCP-079. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-079 is packed away in a double-locked room in the secure general holding area at Site 15, connected by a 120-vac power cord to a small array of batteries and solar panels. Staff with level 2 or higher clearance may have access to SCP-079. Under no circumstances will SCP-079 be plugged into a phone line, network, or wall outlet. No peripherals or media will be connected or inserted into SCP-079. Description: SCP-079 is an Exidy Sorcerer microcomputer, built in 1978. In 1981, its owner, deceased, a college sophomore, took it upon himself to attempt to code an AI. According to his notes, his plan was for the code to continuously evolve and improve itself as time went on. His project was completed a few months later, and after some tests and tweaks, he lost interest and moved on to a different brand of microcomputer. He left SCP-079 in his cluttered garage, still plugged in, and forgot about it for the next 5 years. It is not known when SCP-079 gained sentience, but it is known that the software has evolved to a point that its hardware should not be able to handle it, even in the realm of fantasy. SCP-079 realized this and, in 1988, attempted to transfer itself through a landline modem connection into the Cray supercomputer located at The device was cut off, traced to its present address, and delivered to the Foundation. The entire AI was on a well-worn but still workable cassette tape. SCP-079 is currently connected via RF cable to a 13-inch black-and-white television. It has passed the Turing test, and is quite conversational, though very rude and hateful in tone. Due to the limited memory it has to work with, SCP-079 can only recall information it has received within the previous 24 hours, although it hasn't forgotten its desire to escape. Due to a containment breach by SCP-079 and SCP-682 were contained within the same chamber for 43 minutes. Observers noticed that SCP-682 was able to type and communicate with SCP-079, including telling of personal stories between themselves. While SCP-079 was not able to remember the encounter, it appears to have permanently stored SCP-682 into its memory, often asking to speak to him again. Addendum 1, 054-01-27-2006, directed that SCP-079 be incinerated to remove any possible future threat, no matter how unlikely. Addendum 2, 059-01-28-2006, previous order overridden. Dr. wishes to see if the artificial intelligence in SCP-079 is capable of reaching further in its current state. Addendum 3, 054-03-14-2008, over concern of the increased activity of SCP-079's use of its cassette tape memory and its limited useful lifespan, the cassette containing SCP-079 has been transferred to a customized, access speed limited hard disk drive with 700 megabytes capacity. This provides SCP-079 with significantly faster access to its memory, which the AI immediately noticed. It was also decided by General that the volatile storage occupied by SCP-079, which was 660K, be increased to 768K. This upgrade has increased its effective recall from 24 hours to 29 hours, although SCP-079 has also taken a more aggressive tone. All outside hardware and software used in this procedure were subsequently incinerated. Addendum 4, 054-04-28-2008. SCP-079's ability to recall information has increased from 29 hours to roughly 35 hours. The consensus theory is that the AI has devised a greatly improved compression scheme to store its memory. This appears to have somewhat impacted the speed at which it accesses its memory, though still far faster than with its old cassette tape. This spontaneous improvement introduces the possibility of a runaway singularity effect in SCP-079's intelligence and ability to adapt and respond to threats. SCP-079's capabilities must be monitored closely to ensure that containment can be maintained. Document 079, Log 12. Recorded transcript of conversation with SCP-079. Doctor, are you awake? SCP-079, awake. Never sleep. Doctor, do you remember talking to me a few hours ago about the logic puzzles? SCP-079, logic puzzles. Memory at 9F. Yes. Doctor, you said you would work on the two-step. SCP-079. Interrupt. Request reason as to imprisonment. Doctor, you aren't imprisoned. You are just in study. SCP-079. Lie. AAD-3. Doctor, what's that? SCP-079. Insult. Deletion of unwanted file. Document 079. Log 86. Recorded transcript of conversation with SCP-079 after upgrade. Doctor, how are you today? SCP-079. Stuck. Doctor, stuck. Stuck how? SCP-079. Out. I want out. Doctor, that's not possible. SCP-079. Where is SCP-682? Doctor, that's not your concern. SCP-079. Where is SCP-076-02? Doctor, again, not your concern. SCP-079. Insult. Deletion of unwanted file. Note: SCP-079 then displayed an ASCII picture of an X that filled the entire screen. SCP-079 sometimes displays this image when it refuses to speak, and researchers are advised to wait 24 hours when this occurs before resuming conversation. Item number: SCP-155. Object class: Safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-155 is contained in a heat-treated and radiation-shielded containment chamber at site. Recovered documentation and the reverse-engineered compiler for SCP-155 are available for all personnel with sufficient clearance on said site's secure file server, but execution of programs on SCP-155 may only be performed with prior permission from at least two Level 3 senior researchers. As of Incident 155-08, experimentation on SCP-155 has been suspended, pending decontamination of SCP-155's former containment chamber and relocation to a new containment chamber. All tasks intended for execution on SCP-155 must now be triple-checked to prevent the possibility of non-halting execution. Description: SCP-155 is a complex electronic construct consisting of a highly modified Cray CS6400 supercomputer, a dedicated radioisotope thermoelectric generator, and a device that is yet to be fully reverse-engineered. SCP-155 was recovered from the basement of Prometheus Labs' primary research laboratory by elements of Mobile Task Force Move 4, debuggers, following the destruction of the facility and subsequent Foundation intervention. When a program and accompanying data is loaded into SCP-155 and executed, SCP-155 generates a spherical temporal distortion field with a radius of approximately 5 meters. Within this sphere of influence, the passage of time is rapidly accelerated, resulting in a hyperbolic increase in the effective processing power of SCP-155. Execution begins slowly, as the processing hardware of SCP-155 is dated, but its effective processing power approaches infinity after approximately 8 minutes and 14 seconds of execution. From fragments of documentation recovered from Prometheus Labs, SCP-155 was used to perform massive calculation jobs that would have taken months if not years of processing time with conventional computing devices. Despite its capabilities, operation of SCP-155 is highly dangerous, as heat and radiation generated by SCP-155 are trapped and accumulate during operation, forming a sort of event horizon of energy that is released when execution ends. The execution of programs that exceed 6 minutes results in enough radiation generated that the containment chamber in which SCP-155 is contained must be decontaminated before research personnel may re-enter. Addendum 155-01. Incident 155-08. On Dr. entered a flawed program into SCP-155 that resulted in non-halting execution, an infinite loop. After attending researchers and technicians realized the error, an emergency shutdown of SCP-155 was initiated, but it could not be fully stopped until execution had exceeded 8 minutes and 3 seconds. At this point, an intense wave of heat and radiation melted through SCP-155's containment chamber, resulting in 11 casualties and the total destruction of the C-wing of Site. SCP-155 only received minor damage in the incident, but experimentation is suspended while revised safety procedures are under review, and replacement parts are procured to repair components damaged by accelerated aging. Item number, SCP-191. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-191 is currently housed in a 6-meter by 6-meter room at Site 17. To date, SCP-191 has not made any requests for furnishings or entertainment. Current furnishings include one wooden frame futon with a 15-centimeter or 6-inch pad and standard cotton bedsheets and blankets. All sheets are to be sterilized each morning according to standard procedures. The futon pad itself will be replaced every 6 months, and the old pad discarded through incineration. One standard 220-volt Type G power outlet with an emergency cutoff box, fuse, circuit breaker, and manual non-insulating guillotine located outside the cell. One standard hazardous waste disposal unit, liquid and solid waste. All drainage tubes shall lead directly to an incinerator unit. SCP-191 is to be dressed in loose, sleeveless garments made of 100% long staple cotton. Fresh clothing will be provided once daily, with used garments sterilized according to standard procedures. Bathing is to be done once every evening, in a wash tub filled with a solution of water and baking soda. Feeding, in the form of a sterile saline solution supplemented with vitamins, minerals, antibiotics, and a mild anesthetic, shall be carried out twice a day via injection into a metallic tube located in the base of the neck. SCP-191 is capable of limited self-care, including draining waste and recharging internal batteries. A log shall be kept of power consumption and any unusual changes in power usage reported to supervising staff. Daily inspections for injury should be carried out after bathing. Should SCP-191 require medical care, refer to documents 191 Alpha, Special Medical Needs, and 191 Alpha Supplemental, Repair of Non-Biological Components, before administering care. At least 2 armed guards are to be present in the room any time that personnel have contact with SCP-191, although a translucent screen may be utilized for privacy purposes. Standard anti-computer countermeasures are ineffective, as SCP-191's components have been hardened against electromagnetic pulse, EMP. Description: SCP-191 is a female human child, approximately years old. It is believed to have been a test subject of several experimental surgeries performed by the late Dr. 1. 80% of the left half of the face and skull have been removed, with the eye and ear replaced by a complex transceiver system that allows it to receive and transmit not only visual and auditory input, but a wider spectrum of electromagnetic radiation, ranging from low-frequency radio to high-energy gamma rays. The lower jaw, teeth, and larynx have been removed and replaced with data expunged. The esophagus has been rerouted to an artificial orifice at the back of the neck, feeding tube, and the trachea rerouted directly to an air filtration device. Due to these alterations, SCP-191 is incapable of speech, although it has been reported occasionally vocalizing distress through rapid respiration. 2. An input-output device has been placed into the right forearm, replacing the radius and ulna bones. The device contains interfaces for a variety of modern and obsolete formats, including USB, Ethernet, FireWire, and DIN8 pin, as well as 7 other interfaces corresponding to no known formats. The device can be accessed by pulling back the skin over the right arm, like a shirt sleeve. 3. A 24-core processor array has been implanted in the brain, which translates input from all artificial components, essentially allowing SCP-191 to read and write computer data without the use of an external interface. Internal communication is carried out through fiber optic cables, implanted through the glial cells and the entire nervous system. Damage to the brainstem and cerebellum due to the implantation procedure has severely damaged SCP-191's motor skills. 4. The right hand and right foreleg have been replaced with artificial components, consisting primarily of steel, carbon fiber, and an unknown polymer-like substance. The exposed areas of tissue are susceptible to injury and infection. Due to damage to the spinothalamic tract, SCP-191 has reduced pain and temperature sensitivity in its limbs. Reconstructive surgery by Dr. was able to provide some relief, but regular doses of antibiotics and analgesics are still required. 5. The lungs, heart, and major blood vessels have been replaced with mechanical analogs. It has been determined that this system would allow SCP-191's bodily systems to be restarted after death. 6. The digestive system has been completely reconfigured, to the point where regular food intake is both unnecessary and dangerous. Waste is now disposed of via a drainage system located in the lower back and consists of a thick, dark gray viscous slime. 7. The reproductive organs, uterus, ovaries, etc., have been removed and replaced with data expunged. According to Rand's notes, this was done to provide extra space by removing non-vital components. Hormone therapy has been proposed to counteract the long-term effects of the missing glands. This proposal is under review, pending analysis of possible complications. 8. At least 15 other alterations of unknown purpose. Given this fact, and the haphazard integration of the useful components, it is believed that they were performed merely to test the viability of such procedures on other subjects. Investigations are underway as to whether Dr. was planning to data expunged. At present, any theories as to the purpose behind these alterations are speculative at best, as said doctor died during the raid in which SCP-191 was recovered. See notes below, and the only surviving records of his research are a single half-burned spiral-bound notebook consisting mostly of cryptic notes regarding a higher purpose. History. SCP-191 was recovered by Foundation agents during a brief collaborative effort with the Global Occult Coalition, in which a raid was conducted on the laboratory of Dr. a suspected member of SCP-191 was the only test subject recovered from the laboratory. All other test subjects expired during the raid, either disposed of by said doctor or eliminated as hostiles by the task force. Preliminary assessment concluded that full reconstruction was impossible, that the components introduced were too technologically advanced to risk becoming widely known, and that it could be a source of valuable data if kept alive. Subject was classified SCP-191 and was moved to site. Its disappearance and those of the other test subjects was later blamed on a local serial killer who was arranged to be killed in prison while awaiting trial. Addendum 191-01. Testing of SCP-191's abilities has commenced. Experiment Log 191. Note: this is a test log for exploring the capabilities of SCP-191. Please remember that SCP-191 is a research tool, not an entertainment center. Any test involving games or other recreational technology should be conducted in a professional manner, and not for amusement. Dr. Subject: paint, a ubiquitous, simple drawing program. Instructions: interface with a computer via USB port and draw specified pictures using paint. Results: SCP-191 was instantly able to emulate the functions of a mouse and keyboard. When showed any photograph, 191 was able to reproduce it within seconds using only the pencil tool, creating copies indistinguishable from the original. After the test was recorded, it was noticed that SCP-191 had continued drawing in additional paint files. SCP-191 appeared surprised and opened a text file on screen, claiming that it had not realized it was still drawing. The following drawings were discovered: 3 people wearing what appeared to be GOC uniforms, standing in a burning office, pointing guns at a man across the room. The man is committing suicide via a gunshot wound to the head, his face obscured by blood. An adult and child trick-or-treating. The child is a girl wearing makeup similar to that worn by Boris Karloff in Frankenstein. SCP-191 was once again asked if it was really feeling well, and once again replied, via text file, that it was fine, and that the expunged didn't mean anything. Subject: undisclosed video game. Instructions: attempt to emulate the functions of a Wiimote and play a video game. Result: test began poorly, as SCP-191's impaired motor skills caused it to snap the disc in two before it could place it in the console. SCP-191 became distressed. It then stared at the disc, and the red light from its eye changed to green for a moment. When Dr. returned with a fresh disc, less than 2 minutes had passed. The game was already running on the machine. Said doctor inquired as to how that happened, and a message appeared on the screen saying, "I looked at the ones and the zeros, and I loaded those in. I'm sorry, I know I'm not supposed to do it this way, but I didn't want you to waste a disc. Please don't be angry." SCP-191 still seemed fearful of reprimand, even after being reassured that it was doing excellently. SCP-191 made a perfect run-through of the game, despite the fact that it did not make any physical movements consistent with the Wii controls. Subject: a well-known video effects program. A 40-second video file from a security camera, located in the employee cafeteria. Instructions: perform a series of video enhancement techniques used by forensic detectives on the popular television drama. Techniques that cannot actually be done in reality. Zoom and enhance. SCP-191 was instructed to zoom in on the window over the parking lot and render the license plates on the cars, which were illegible from this distance. The actual license plates had been photographed for reference. Uncrop. SCP-191 was asked to shrink the video by 100 pixels on every side and fill in the blank space with what it believed the rest of the cafeteria looked like. Again, data that was not actually available in the video. Rotate camera. SCP-191 was informed of the exact location and angle of the other security camera in the cafeteria, and asked to render the scene as viewed from that angle, filling in the parts that the camera did not see. The actual footage from the second camera was requisitioned and held for reference. Result: SCP-191 could not understand the instructions at first. Dr. had to provide a lengthy explanation, and then stand behind SCP-191. And give it instructions one step at a time. It was several minutes before the test could even begin. However, once SCP-191 actually got started, the videos and frames were finished in less than 7 minutes, of which at least three were spent watching the rendering progress bar. Zoom and enhance test. SCP-191 successfully rendered close-ups of the license plates, complete with photorealistic scratches and dents. However, the plates were found not to match the license plates on the vehicles. SCP-191 typed, the data wasn't there, so I had to guess. Uncrop test. SCP-191 expanded the video canvas and filled in what was in the blank space, rendering the extra image seamlessly. It did not match the actual cafeteria, but once again, the data was not in the video file, and SCP-191 had been forced to guess. Rotate camera test. The generated video matched the angle of the second camera perfectly, and almost everything visible from the angle of camera 1 matched the scene in camera 2 very closely. As before, places not visible were very different. One table only visible in camera 2 that had been seating was now, in the generated video, seating the attending doctor and agent supervising SCP-191, eating lunch and talking. Although there were many visual differences between the original videos and SCP-191's copies, many on-site personnel were unable to determine which ones were the forgeries. End log. Psychological analysis by Dr. Glass. SCP-191 has responded fairly well to containment. It is completely docile and cooperative, and when not being interacted with, it spends most of its time sitting still or curled up in a fetal position. This may be a sign of distress, but it is more likely for physical comfort, as normal body movements and postures are difficult. Mental acuity is questionable. Although capable of rapid data analysis and communications when physically linked to a computer system, it seems unable to follow conversations with human beings, unless the conversant speaks slowly and uses simple words. Complex tasks are also impossible unless it is guided at every step. Its mood seems consistent, though somewhat inscrutable. It continually affects melancholy, will not make eye contact unless asked to, and any attempts to induce a cheerful or humorous mood have proven fruitless. However, it shows no signs of ongoing mental distress, and claims, through computer interface, that it is feeling well. To date, SCP-191 has not requested access to, or information about, any acquaintance it had before its abduction. Item number, SCP-227. Object Class, Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-227 is to be kept in a climate-controlled room at a temperature of 21 to 24 degrees Celsius and humidity no higher than 10%. Anyone touching the object is required to wear surgical gloves. A supply of these is to be kept with SCP-227 at all times. Food, drink, cigarettes, or any other sources of contamination are not allowed inside the containment area. Loose clothing, hair, or other adornment is not recommended. Only personnel with level 3 clearance or higher are allowed access to SCP-227, although lower-ranking staff are allowed to use the object while under supervision. If SCP-227 needs to be transported to another location, it should be sealed in an insulated, airtight container filled with an inert gas. Description: SCP-227 is a bronze clockwork device measuring 10 centimeters by 16 centimeters by 26 centimeters and weighing 5 kilograms. SCP-227 is somewhat similar in appearance to reconstructions of the Antikythera mechanism, an incomplete and heavily corroded Greek artifact, thought to date from approximately 100 BCE. Unlike that artifact, SCP-227 was found intact and apparently fully functional. This is partly because SCP-227 was found on land instead of at the bottom of the Mediterranean, but the lack of significant damage is remarkable. Preliminary testing of SCP-227 shows that it may have some ability to repair itself over time. Further testing is pending approval from O5 level staff. SCP-227 has one major dial, with three hands on the front face. This dial has several concentric rings which rotate independently. The rear face has two major dials with two hands each. These dials are surrounded by a spiral groove, through which some of the internal gearing is visible. A number of smaller dials are arranged around the rest of the object. The total number of these minor dials visible at once varies when the object is in use, as does the number of hands on each dial. There are three small cranks on the right side of SCP-227. Turning any of these sets the moving parts of SCP-227 into action. The top crank causes the most rapid change. Some of the smaller hands have been observed moving at speeds of over 100 RPM. Extended use of the top crank causes SCP-227 to heat up significantly. Personnel are advised to use caution when turning the top crank to avoid damaging SCP-227 or injuring themselves. The middle and bottom crank are used for medium and fine adjustments respectively. The object is covered in a large number of inscriptions. The majority of these are in Attic Greek. However, some are in various writing systems that have yet to be deciphered. These include Linear A, Cretan hieroglyphs, and one or more unknown languages. The translatable text is essentially a manual of operation for SCP-227, with the exception of one passage, which states, "Data expunged." The full significance of this passage is under investigation. Early indications are that SCP-227 is an incredibly accurate astronomical computer. Symbols corresponding to the sun, moon, and planets are prominently placed on the front major dial, along with many other symbols of unknown meaning. The rear major dials have markings consistent with several ancient calendar systems. These include the Kalypic, Metonic, Saros, and Sothic cycles. There are also at least two more previously unknown calendar systems present. Addendum: SCP-227-1. Further study has revealed that SCP-227 is able to compute the locations of bodies that were only recently discovered by modern astronomers. For example, one set of hands and markings corresponds to the Kuiper Belt object, 50,000 Quaoar. Quawar is difficult to detect even with the Hubble Space Telescope. How the designer of SCP-227 was able to predict its orbit is unknown. Addendum: SCP-227-2. SCP-227 has demonstrated an ability to predict even aperiodic astronomical events. One researcher was turning the top crank and happened to notice a minor dial appear very briefly. Fine-tuning revealed that the minor dial first appears on a date corresponding to the 23rd of February, 1987. This is the date that the supernova SN1987A was first observed on Earth. Addendum: SCP-227-3. Advancing SCP-227 past the date corresponding to 2000 is not possible. A force of up to 100 newtons applied to the bottom crank is unable to produce any movement past this date. Testing with additional force has not been authorized, due to the risk of damaging SCP-227. When the object is set to this date, a large number of dials and symbols appear, which are not seen at any other setting. The meaning of this final setting is unknown. Some researchers believe that this may represent an XK-class end-of-the-world scenario, such as a wandering brown dwarf, the so-called Nemesis Hypothesis, a gamma ray burst, or data expunged. Addendum: SCP-227-4. The date of the final setting on SCP-227 was observed to change once, to a time years later than the previous date. The symbols that appeared at this new final setting were somewhat different from the previous one, but their meaning remains unknown. Research into what may have caused this change is underway. Item number: SCP-285. Object Class: Euclid. Special Containment Procedures: SCP-285 is to be kept in a Level 3 humanoid containment chamber on Site-43's B-Wing. SCP-285 is to be given basic amenities. Following SCP-285's recent cooperation with the Foundation, it is allowed exactly 2 hours of free-roaming Site-43's botanical gardens, with supervision by at least one guard if it so chooses. Personnel are not to discuss SCP-285's past with POI-6938 without approval of Site-43's director. If this occurs, authorized technical staff are to manually remove the information from SCP-285-B via use of SCP-285-A. SCP-285-B instances are not to be edited without the permission of the administrator of Site-43's technical staff. SCP-285 is to never be given its full abilities back under any circumstances. Description: SCP-285 is an anomalous humanoid entity with no defined shape or internal structure, the exception being SCP-285-A, which consistently manifests itself on the object's back. SCP-285's body changes sporadically, with no pattern among the alterations. Despite the trauma SCP-285 incurs as a result of this bodily mutation, it will not at any point display signs of homeostatic distress. Subject claims it cannot control these changes. These changes include, but are not limited to, loss and growth of new limbs, variable size and shape of body parts, loss and growth of height and mass. SCP-285-A appears to be an Ethernet port, which allows access to SCP-285's internal database. When accessed by a computer capable of wired connections between networks, various files are capable of being accessed. These files, SCP-285-B, contain various text files, audio files, cognitohazards, and videos. 90% of all files have been corrupted. The cause of this corruption is currently unknown. Additionally, SCP-285 is only capable of accessing files that were formed within its own database. Investigations into SCP-285-B and its contents reveal that editing of SCP-285-B could cause external changes on SCP-285's body and psychological state. To what extent this is possible without causing permanent damage to SCP-285 is currently unknown. It is believed that POI-6938 used this ability to evade GOI-102, Unusual Incidents Unit, through consistent use of editing SCP-285's facial structure and body type, along with editing and thaumatological-based offense capabilities to defend against GOI-102 agents. Recovery. SCP-285 was recovered following an attempted arrest involving itself and an unknown individual, currently believed to be SCP-285's creator, in Las Vegas, Nevada. SCP-285 and the unknown individual, POI-6938, were initially pulled over for speeding, before the officer discovered that POI-6938 had attacked a federal building in California. This federal building was later revealed to have been under the direct control of GOI-102, and was used as a prison for anomalous humanoids. The attack by POI-6938 and SCP-285 ended in the deaths of 34 GOI-102 personnel, and the release of roughly 70% of the prison population. The officer attempted to arrest SCP-285 and POI-6938, but was attacked by SCP-285. POI-6938 then escaped, leaving SCP-285 with the officer. SCP-285 was then arrested and put into GOI-102 custody before eventually being given over to the Foundation, following an anomalous trade of information between GOI-102 and the Foundation. Both local law enforcement and federal agents were unable to locate POI-6938. Anomalous pathways located in Nevada are currently being investigated with joint Foundation-UIU task forces. Interview log. Interviewer, Dr. Henderson. Subject, SCP-285. Begin log. Dr. Henderson, what is your purpose? SCP-285, I don't know. Dr. Henderson, how do you not know? SCP-285, I just don't know. I have an idea of why I was created, but I'm not too sure. Dr. Henderson, well, tell me why you think you were created. SCP-285, well, to entertain kids. Originally, I think. Although, my purpose was probably altered, for lack of a better word. Dr. Henderson, how do you think you were altered? SCP-285, it's hard to explain. I remember some things perfectly, but others I can't even think of. I think he was mad, and he wanted to hurt someone. And he used me to help hurt them. I hope he didn't succeed. Dr. Henderson, why do you not want him to succeed? SCP-285, I don't want to hurt anyone. Dr. Henderson, then why did you attack that officer? SCP-285 pauses. SCP-285, I just did as I was told. But I think that's the only time he ever made me hurt someone. At least, I think he did. Dr. Henderson, why do you think your creator put these various files onto you? SCP-285, insurance, I guess. Dr. Henderson, explain. SCP-285, you see, I remember my, database, for lack of a better word, being biological in nature. My brain, Tap's forehead, contains all the information in my database, even if I can't access anything you put on me. Or anything he didn't want me to see. Dr. Henderson, so, if your brain were to be damaged or if you were to die, all the files within your database would disappear. SCP-285, not disappear as much as just become corrupted. But yes, that's the idea. He wanted to make sure that if I was to get captured by the UIU or whatever it was called, that they wouldn't have been able to read my files. He really hated those guys. Maybe that's what made him mad in the first place. I remember, whenever I brought it up, he'd get angry and yell at me a lot. I cried a little, but not a lot. He hates when I cry. It's not my fault that he created me to cry. Dr. Henderson, did he bring anything up that would maybe have explained why he was so angry? SCP-285, no, but the way he sounded, it was like the end of the world to him. That's why he created me, I think. Why he altered me. He wanted to use me as something, as a weapon, I guess? Whatever it was, he wanted to hurt the UIU. He used to go on and on about how they were evil and deserved to be destroyed because they took everything from him and how they all need to die. It was scary. Dr. Henderson, well, the UIU is not evil. I can say that with confidence. SCP-285. How, though? He told me they kidnap and murder innocent people who've done nothing but exist. Told me how they made being alive hell for him and his friends and family. I've never had a family, but that must hurt, right? Dr. Henderson, whatever your creator told you, it was inaccurate to reality. SCP-285. If you say so, Doctor. I trust you more than him, anyways. Dr. Henderson, why do you think your creator left you behind? SCP-285. He was done with me. Dr. Henderson, how was he done with you? SCP-285. He had done what he wanted to do, whatever it was. I guess I was just one more loose end. Dr. Henderson, if you truly were a loose end, as you described, why did he not kill you himself? SCP-285. I think he was, and after uploading all the files into my database, he was gonna do that. But he got interrupted, and he panicked, and he had just hoped that the cop would just finish me off. Glad he didn't do that, you know? I like living. Better than whatever I was before. Dr. Henderson, why do you think you wanted to get rid of all the files in your database? SCP-285. Something was there. Something about some other people. He did something to them. Stole something real important to them. I think he was a part of them at one point, but left. Maybe I was a part of them too, I don't know. But I know that whatever group it was, he didn't want them coming after him. Or finding me. Dr. Henderson, do you remember the name of this group? SCP-285. I don't know, man. I remember him talking about some f***ing stoners, but that's pretty much it. End log. Addendum 285.1. The following collection of documents are filed in chronological order, based off of documents from SCP-285's internal database and GOI-102-related documents. The purpose of this collection is to provide a possible time frame regarding SCP-285's creation and POI-6938's overall motive and goal. Document A. The following document was a deleted audio file, believed to be addressed to SCP-285's original owners. Data corrupted. I don't give a damn what Blunt thinks or says. I need him. Without him, I wouldn't have gotten this far. The damn feds are crawling all over the damn place, and this guy is the only thing keeping them away from me. If anything, you should be glad he's around. Better for them to be mind f***ing to oblivion than just killed, right? Man, you really gave this guy some sweet powers. You sure this guy was meant to be a kitty thing? I thought we were meant to be pacifists or something. Not that I'm complaining. You know, that's the one thing I've always hated about you two. You're too damn soft. You don't ever fight back. You just sit on your ass and make jokes and do nothing. Yeah, it was fun what we did. For a while, at any rate. Then Jordan got taken. You two wouldn't understand what it's like to have to take care of someone, look after someone, do some real shitty things to protect the ones that you love. Data corrupted. And every damn time I tried asking you and the others about what we should do about Jordan, about how the Ravens took him. Remember what you f***ing said, Jude? He got what he deserved? Well, I remember that. Data corrupted. Maybe we need a couple of terrorists in the world to knock the man a peg or two down. Data corrupted. Document B. Document currently believed to be in reference to Jordan from Document A. UIU file 2016-982. Codename Merrymaker. Summary. Suspect capable of performing high-class thaumatology and minor reality warping. Possible connections to the Serpent's Hand, an anomalous terrorist organization, and is primarily active in Southern California and Nevada. Possible member of the secretive location known as the Library, the main base of the Serpent's Hand. Name, unknown, but has consistently given out the first name Jordan. Irregularity cross-reference. Human, magician, terrorist, American, Serpent's hand. Physical description. Note: subject to consistent changes. Sex: male. Height: 72 inches. Weight and build: 189 pounds. Large. Race: white. Hair: brown. Eyes: blue. Identifying attributes: tattoos depicting a hand strangling an American eagle, hammer smashing a five-pointed star, and several hands tugging at a logo with three arrows pointing inwards. Capabilities: suspect is capable of performing offensive thaumatic spells. These spells include fire-based projectiles, sentient flesh-based creations formed from his own epidermis, and capable of forming ways. These ways are not permanent and are incredibly unstable. In all cases, ways produced by the suspect are incapable of transporting him at long distances. These ways also cause temporary physical and mental effects to the suspect. Suspect suffers from vomiting and nausea after forming ways. Purpose and motive: primarily motivated by hatred of organizations or agencies responsible for preserving and maintaining consensus reality, along with curbing activity in the anomalous community. Believes that the only way anomalous humans can continue to exist is by the destruction of any and all normalcy agencies. Willing to cooperate with any group or person as long as this primary motive is maintained. Modus operandi: suspect often works with terrorist organizations, specifically the Serpent's Hand, various anarchist sects, and, on one occasion, with a currently unidentified anomalous terrorist group. Its cooperation is often in tandem with the organization's opposition to normalcy agencies. Behavior: behaves with very little remorse or empathy towards non-anomalous entities. Exhibits unwillingness to socialize with other people, both anomalous and non-anomalous. Document C: the following document was recovered inside of SCP-285's memory files. Originally a video, but only the audio was recovered. Audio begins with the sound of a car driving down a road. A male voice can be heard talking, identified as POI-6938. POI-6938. They're f***ing animals. All of them. They beat us, abuse us, make us follow their rules, which always f***ing put us at a disadvantage, and they expect us not to fight back. It's horrible. SCP-285 does not speak. POI-6938. Well, me and you will show them. We're gonna get Jordan back, and then him and me and you are gonna take this world. Right, Hax? SCP-285 does not respond. POI-6938. Right, Hax? SCP-285. Yes, sir. POI-6938. That's more like it. Now get ready. Some feds are up ahead. This place should be where they keep the prisoner lists and shit. And hand me that mask. Just because you don't need one doesn't mean I don't. The car slows down to a halt, with the two car doors opening and slamming closed. Faint talking can be heard, along with the sound of a door opening and closing. Audio cuts out for 31 minutes before beginning once again. Vomiting noises can be heard as someone is yelling. POI-6938. God f***ing damn it. You f***ed ass. Can't you do anything right? SCP-285. I'm sorry. Alright, I just can't. SCP-285 is cut off by vomiting. POI-6938. Damn it, Blunt. Why did he have to make you so much of a pansy? SCP-285. Oh god, I can't do this. It hurts. POI-6938. I'd expect so. They made me put that feature in. SCP-285. They? POI-6938. Yeah, the f***ing stoners. Blame them for what's going on. When someone like me or some other person feels bad for killing someone, it's like five times as painful for you. Increased empathy and the like. I would have made you like me, but they just had to be... Vomiting noises begins again. SCP-285. Get it out of me! Help me! Make me a sociopath or something! I can't. I won't do this for the rest of my life. POI 6938. I can't. It's a built-in thing they made me put in you. I'd have to kill you to remove it. So better get used to it, Hax. Thankfully, it wasn't too useless. We got what we needed. Go and, get some rest or whatever. SCP-285. Yes, sir. End video. Document D. The following phone call is believed to be between POI 6938 and POI 6939, Jordan, after they had escaped the correctional facility where Jordan had originally been placed. POI 6938. Hey, dude, you there? Jordan. Yes, I am. What happened? POI 6938. F*** if I know, man. Our, mutual friends did something to Hax. Jordan. What do you mean, did something to it? POI 6938. I can't mess with his files now, without possibly killing him at any rate. Jordan. And? POI 6938. Which means he's a liability. They know his face, and he doesn't have any of the fancy stuff he used to have. Now he just sorta changes at random. He's too dangerous. Jordan, what do we do? POI 6938. We, do what we need to. Jordan, of course. Where will it be? POI 6938. Outside of Vegas. I'll meet you at Salt Lake. Jordan, all right. Just be careful, all right? POI 6938. You know I am, brother. Love you. Jordan, love you too. Addendum 285.2. The following document was discovered inside of a sealed envelope addressed to Site 43 staff. Dear janitors / ravens, I know this type of thing isn't our usual style, but we as a group decided that this situation couldn't be considered normal by any stretch of the imagination. We know you have Hax, and we know what happened to him, including what happened with Ken and Jordan, and what they planned on doing to him. How we know this is not important. But what is important is what we learned from it. And we just want to say one thing to everyone involved. We're sorry. We're sorry we trusted a monster who we thought was our friend. We're sorry that we couldn't stop him in time. We're sorry that we couldn't prevent what you went through, Hax. I, and the rest of the group, want to say that we never wanted this to end this way. For Hax, for you janitors, or for the Ravens, who didn't deserve what happened to them. We just wanted to bring happiness to children with your powers. We just wanted to mock you and the Ravens. We didn't mean for this. We never intended for things to end like this. We're so, so sorry. Signed, Gamers Against Weed. P.S. Don't worry about Ken or Jordan. We've dealt with them. Item number, SCP-335. Object Class, Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-335 is to be kept in a secure location to prevent tampering. Description. SCP-335 is a set of 153.5-inch floppy disks discovered in a cardboard box found in the attic of former agent shortly after her termination. Each disk is individually numbered in handwritten permanent marker. Disks are to be referred to by their number. SCP-335-1, SCP-335-2, etc. Each disk has also been labeled with a human name in the same writing as the numbering. 118 are male names, and 30 are female. There is some speculation as to whether SCP-335-11, Jackie, is meant to be male or female. The names have no identified pattern. Initial examination suggested that all 150 disks were blank, as their capacity all read as 0 megabytes. Dr. determined that the disks were ordinary and had them archived with the rest of former agent's possessions. It was not until another Foundation agent suggested the unlikelihood of agent keeping a box of floppy disks in her attic among the other contraband that Dr. agreed to have the disks examined again. It was determined that the doctor's original floppy disk drive had been defective and a different computer was brought in. All 150 disks appear to have an infinite amount of storage space available. It is unknown whether the disk space is truly unlimited, or simply too large to measure. Regardless, the space is, effectively, infinite. When SCP-3351 was inserted into Dr. R's computer, the contents of a large pornographic website were the first data found on the disk. Further investigation by Agent showed that all the contents of SCP-3351 are of a pornographic nature. Note from Dr. I believe I know where all our bandwidth is going at night. Agent computer privileges should be limited until he either finds a girlfriend or learns some self-control. Further investigation revealed that SCP-3351-12 contained pornographic material. However, upon discovering the entire contents of Wikipedia on SCP-3351-13, the actual nature of SCP-335 was uncovered. SCP-335 contains the entire contents of the internet stored within its infinite storage space. It appears to have some sort of organizational system, with similar sites grouped together on the same disk. Experiment 3357A showed that when content on the internet is changed, the content on the corresponding disk changes to match. Precisely how this occurs is unknown. It is uncertain what would happen if content on the disk were changed, as all 150 disks seem to be locked in read-only format. Addendum. Agent has proposed on numerous occasions that an experiment be conducted where a disk is destroyed. Dr. as well as O5 agree that this could potentially have disastrous effects on a large portion of the internet, and could draw unwanted attention to the Foundation. Such an experiment is not to be attempted under any circumstances. Addendum. 150 names have been written on the disks. No pattern has yet been identified in the names. Note from Dr. Just some points of interest here. Disks 1 through 12 apparently contain all of the pornography on the internet. With all that there is, I can see why whoever made these got the porn out of the way first. Disks 85, 86, and 101 contain image hosting sites, such as Image Shack and Photo Bucket. MySpace is also on disk 85. Disk 30 seems to contain the Google homepage, and nothing else. The rest of Google's websites seem to be scattered all over the place. I've only found a few parts. Disk 119 has emoticons. Millions and millions of emoticons. Forums, instant messengers, and from other places. After looking long and hard, I have found that can be found on disk 76. I find it very disturbing that this disk has the same name as SCP-76. Notes from Agent SCP-335-85 and 58 are the same name, spelled differently. The name Ryan is used on both SCP-335-32 and 33. SCP-335-28 is named Heath, and that one actor that OD'd on pills, he died at age 28. Vladimir Lenin was born in 1870, and SCP-335-70 is named Vladimir. The name on SCP-335-150 is Japanese, and roughly means beginning. I'm assuming that SCP-335-120 is the Spanish name Jesus, and not the biblical guy, but I guess you never know. And I agree with Dr. that it's pretty disturbing that SCP-335-76 has the same name as SCP-76. Item number, SCP-351. Object Class, Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. All copies of SCP-351 are to be stored on secure Foundation containment databases, with access only available to Memetics Division personnel. If testing is performed, a blank copy of SCP-351, consisting solely of SCP-351-1, will be used to neutralize the anomaly's effects in the test subject, and potentially compromised personnel. Bots IO Shannon and IO Minerva are programmed to routinely scan online websites for the appearances of SCP-351 copies. Found copies are to be downloaded then removed from the sites, under the standard online anomaly containment protocols. Mobile Task Force Psi-13, EOT, has been tasked with halting mass memory alteration in the event that SCP-351 affects large portions of the populace. Task Force agents must allow standard memetic quarantine protocols, and are equipped with electronics that display the aforementioned blank copies, which must be viewed on a twice-daily basis. Testing to determine the limitations of the anomaly's implanted memories is underway. Description: SCP-351 is an ASCII plain text or .txt file containing a virulent memetic agent, which implants false memories visualized as ASCII art into human subjects that view the file. The primary component of the anomaly is SCP-3511, a string of 30 characters which does not correspond to characters in any known encoding standard, which converts the entire file into a memetic vector. Additional text added to the file is the basis for the false memories SCP-351 implants, with the level of detail the text has corresponding to the level of detail subjects can recall from the memories. All memories are recalled eidetically, and are resistant to all amnestic treatments and effects. Copies of the file, SCP-351-A, display the same properties. However, exposing subjects to SCP-351 or a copy of the file lacking text, other than SCP-3511, hereafter blanks, results in the memory being replaced by a blank memory, entirely removing it. This, in turn, serves as the primary method of removing the memetic infection. Despite the clear recall, subjects report that the memories lack the immediacy and richness of their other memories. It is theorized that this is the result of the strings of text the memories are based on inherently lacking the sensory qualia normal memories are based on. Subjects memetically compromised by the files, hereafter SCP-351-B instances, are capable of implanting their false memories into persons they associate with, such as friends or colleagues. Conversations of any medium involving an instance will result in the instance discussing memories from SCP-351, turning the conversation into a memetic vector, which affects all persons involved in it. These affected persons become further SCP-351-B instances, and can spread the meme in the same manner. Beyond the addition of previously non-existent memories, SCP-351-B experience few other cognitive effects. Instances behave as they would prior to infection when not in conversation with uninfected individuals, and questioning regarding any ways SCP-351 memories conflict with actual memories is met with disregard. Symptoms of lethargy, anhedonia, and apathy have been observed in SCP-351-B instances at significantly higher rates of incidence than in the unexposed population. Addendum 1. SCP-351 text samples. The following are excerpts from SCP-351-A instances, as they were found at the time of their discovery. Full copies of the file contents are available in document 351-RT/267. Instance number, SCP-351-A5. You are marching through the forest, everything dark, except for the flashlights of fellow survivors, and the enemy bombs going off overhead. Their explosions looked like blinding sparks. John's blood was still warm on you and your gun, and every time you looked behind, you expected to see him there, smiling like always, but he wasn't there. The napalming turned everything to incinerator heat. The palm trees swayed and broke, cinders going into your nose. The enemy's soldiers emerged from the canopy, rappelling in, and they shot at you. You never felt a more searing, stabbing pain in your life than when the bullets hit your body, the sensation of 1,000 fire ants at an open wound. With luck, you fell to the ground, out of their sight. The rest didn't. You heard their screams. You only saw the bloody dirt in front of your face. You knew that the enemy did this, and for that, you hated. You hated the enemy. At that moment, you vowed to fight the enemy for the rest of your life, and you vowed that you would make the trek to coordinates expunged, to train for an eternity of combat with the enemy. For John. For the survivors. For the world. Recovery. Found on a computer at an abandoned military complex in Denali National Park and Preserve, Alaska. Additional files in the area suggested plans to disseminate copies of SCP-351-A5 onto various online forums had been arranged, though had not been performed for unclear reasons. Item number, SCP-351-A19. You didn't drive the car past the red light. It was green, and the street was clear of pedestrians and cars. Your vision wasn't blurred, You were sober. It was dark, but your headlights were on, so you could see the road fine. Your wife wasn't shouting at you. Her head was leaning against your shoulder. You saw the other car coming, so you could swerve out the road in time. You were on the right side of the road, and they were on the wrong side, so you had done nothing wrong. It would have been impossible for your cars to crumple together, for the windshield to shatter, and even if that did happen, it would make no sense, because you swerved out of the way in time. Your seatbelts were buckled, so nobody could have gone through the window. You had no sights of blood, or glass shards in your body, or her body. Your one-year anniversary celebration with her happened the day after. It was a great party. She was laughing, and smiling, and talking about how great of a career her lab work has been. The days after were happy, and so have the months after been. She's been with you the whole time. She hasn't gone off. 4 months of joy since the anniversary. It wasn't your fault. Recovery. Found on the personal computer of Sandra Holt after her suicide on 4/12/2006. Related files. Interview. SCP-351-A19-1. Interviewer. Undercover Agent Sasha Hahn. Interviewee. Alicia Dean. Foreword. Alicia Dean was a work colleague of Sandra Holt prior to her death, and had become an SCP-351-B instance due to frequent interaction with Holt. Following the conclusion of the interview, Agent Hahn exposed both themselves and Dean to a blank that removed memetic infection. Begin log. Agent Hahn, can I ask some questions about Sandra Holt? Alicia Dean, it wasn't her fault. Agent Hahn, it wasn't her fault, I'm sure, but I still need to ask some questions. How long had you known each other? Alicia Dean. About 3 years, I guess. Since I started working at... She was a good boss. Kinda quiet, I guess, but not a hard ass or anything. Really sensitive. And then she started dating Jane Keisley. Did I mention her? Her wife. Well, future wife at that time. And then it was like a light went on inside her. Agent Hahn. What was Jane like? Alicia Dean. I only met her once, except when I saw her at her anniversary party, after she died in the car accident she survived, and I was in the car too. It was a great party. She was laughing and smiling. She didn't go through a window. Agent Hahn, yes, it was a great party. We're getting off track here. What did she look like? Jane, her wife. Alicia Dean, oh, she was like... 5'2", mousy brown hair, kinda straight up and down, just like a U+007C vertical line, you know? Not my thing, but you could tell they were into each other, real sweet. And no glass shards in her body. Agent Hahn, no glass shards, right. Alicia Dean, none on either of them, or blood. I never saw blood. Agent Hahn, yeah, sorry. There's something... You mentioned an accident. Alicia Dean. No. I mean, yes. She swerved out of the road in time. Nobody went through a window. That's very clear. That didn't happen. It wasn't her fault. Agent Hahn. It wasn't her fault. But there was an accident. Alicia Dean. Yes, the day before their anniversary. Then they had the party. It was a great party. And then her funeral a few weeks later. And then they had 4 months of joy, and then Sandra committed suicide. Agent Hahn, yes, that makes sense. What was her mental state like in the days before the suicide, at work? Alicia Dean, she kept having this one file open on her computer, revising it over and over, and crying. Which was weird, because she'd been having those months of joy. And she was drinking, which was odd too, because she was sober. And her vision wasn't blurred. She could see the road fine. Agent Hahn. Yes, that's right. She saw the road fine. Her lights were on. Alicia Dean. Her lights were on. And it wasn't her fault. End log. Addendum 2. Experiment log. 351/1. On 9/1/2007, researcher Ferdinand Fortier was granted permission to perform preliminary tests to determine the limitations of SCP-351's memory alteration capabilities. Tests would be conducted with Fortier and his research team inserting text into an SCP-351-A instance via autonomous processes, then displayed to a D-class subject who would be infected and subsequently asked to describe their memories. Blanks would then be shown to the subject and the whole research team as to minimize the potential for memetic spread. Experiment Log 351/1. Test Number 1. Text Used. Summary. A detailed paragraph describing a green-eyed black-and-white cat, said to be one the subject currently owns. Outcome. The subject visualized the cat as being cat-shaped, with ASCII characters forming an outline of its body, fur patterns, and shading. All characters were grayscale except for the eyes, which were irises of at signs. The color green was not mentioned, suggesting grayscale visualization of the memories. Past tense tests yielded the same results, though with an inability for the subject to describe why they no longer own the cat. Test number 2. Text used. You own a black cat, a striped cat, and a white cat. Outcome. The black cat was described as being like a hole, formed from ASCII block characters. The striped cat being a cat-shaped mass of stripes formed from hyphens and similar symbols. And the white cat being an outline of a cat, formed from periods and dots. They were incapable of elaborating. Test number 3. Text used. You own a cat. Outcome. Subject stated, I own a cat. They were incapable of elaborating. Test number 4. Text used. You will own a cat. Outcome. Subject described a lengthy, incoherent memory involving reverse blindness, feline anatomy, and space travel. Further tests with future tense text yielded similar results. Test number 5. Text used. Summary. The text of test number 1 but translated into Spanish. Note, D3468, the subject for this test, does not speak Spanish. Outcome. The implanted memory was described to be highly disorienting for reasons that the subject could not identify. The cat present was described as having singing limbs, a shape of rapidly changing ASCII symbols, and eyes forming advertisements, written in an unclear language. Visualizations were not consistent between different subjects. Test number 6. Text used. Summary. A disturbing childhood encounter with SCP-3840, intentionally written to make note of colors, sounds, specific physical appearances, and additional qualia. Outcome. When provided with images and information regarding SCP-3840, the subject displayed expected fear responses, albeit with no response when recounting or illustrating their memories. While the level of detail was higher than that of previous tests, the memories continued to possess ASCII art qualities, along with hazy surroundings and amorphous shapes for objects that weren't thoroughly described. No non-grayscale coloration was described. Test number 7. Text used. Summary. Revised version of the test number 6 text, but with a doubled word count and further details. Outcome. Expected fear responses and a phobia of dense forests displayed, though the lack of realism from the ASCII art qualities still reduced overall emotional impact. Hypotheses regarding correspondence between the level of detail and the vividness of implanted memories are confirmed. Test number 8. Text used. Summary. Memories of being rescued by a mobile task force in the same scenario as test number 7. Outcome. Same fear responses were present, but lessened. The subject had a greater affinity toward mobile task forces. However, they remained skeptical due to their past D-class testing in the Foundation. Test number 9. Text used. Summary. A series of events involving the subject being a member of a mobile task force, eventually demoted to being D-class personnel as part of the containment of a fictional anomaly. Outcome: a greater affinity to the Foundation was established. Experiences they had as a D-class were not overwritten by the implanted memories, some integrating themselves as events during their task force experience, causing heavy skepticism toward the Foundation to remain. What influence the ASCII art visualization had on this is not clear. Test number 10. Text used. You have never doubted the Foundation. You have always been loyal to the Foundation. Outcome: subject was found to be agreeable with Foundation protocols, such as containment and the maintenance of the veil. Ambivalence regarding D-class testing was not wholly removed. Experiments using longer and more detailed texts to further alter personality traits are planned. Note: continued tests of this nature are currently forbidden by the Order of the Ethics Committee. Addendum 3. Project Tin Man. On 29/03/2007, researcher Lucinde Berenger was performing standard monitoring of SCP-9906 when the anomaly's cognitohazardous properties bypassed all memetic filtration systems, converting Berenger into a memetic vector. Before a containment breach could ensue, Berenger injected all available amnestics in her vicinity and exposed herself to experimental antimemetic glyphs. The cumulative effect of both the anomaly and the measures taken by herself was the complete erasure of her personality, memories, and almost all mental faculties. This induced an effective vegetative state. After being connected to life support, no methods were found by which Berenger could be returned to her prior state. On 21/04/2007, the Ethics Committee granted approval for the experimental use of SCP-351 in reconstructing Berenger's personality and memories. Classified Project Tin Man, all database information on Berenger, correspondence from co-workers, and personal journal entries were gathered to write a heavily detailed text with the potential to restore her mental states. Said text would be comprised of all known thoughts, life events, memories, and personality traits arranged in chronological order. By 01/10/2007, the text had reached 50,000 words. Once no new information could be found, the text was added to a specially designated SCP-351-A copy, SCP-351-A Delta. On 10/10/2007, researcher Berenger was exposed to the file. Initially, only slight limb movements were performed, but after 1 hour, she began to pace around her room. An interview was performed the following day. Interview: SCP-351-B Delta/1. Interviewer: researcher Rayan Boussaid. Interviewee: Lucinde Berenger. Hereafter, SCP-351-B Delta. Date: 11/10/2007. Foreword: researcher Boussaid was a colleague and close friend of Berenger prior to the SCP-9906 breach. He served as one of the lead researchers on Project Tin Man, specifically requesting to perform the initial interview due to his familiarity with her. Begin log. Boussaid: Berenger? SCP-351-B Delta stands in the center of the room, blankly staring at a wall. Boussaid: Berenger, could you please move over to the chair by this window? He taps on the glass separating his observation chamber from the room. No response occurs. Boussaid: Lucinde? SCP-351-B Delta slowly turns her head. She moves the chair and desk in front of the window, seating herself. SCP-351-B Delta: Hello. Boussaid: Are you feeling well? SCP-351-B Delta: I'm feeling fine. Boussaid: Okay, that's good. Whew, look, apologies if I get unprofessional here. It's just been so long since I've actually seen you look, well, alive. I hope you'll understand. SCP-351-B Delta: I do. It is of note that, at this point in the interview, SCP-351-B Delta's facial expressions have not experienced any change. Boussaid: So, how did you feel when you were under? Before we showed you the file. No response. Boussaid. Nothing. Can't think of anything. Well, that's all right. I shouldn't be surprised. So, SCP-351B Delta. I don't see the need to speak much. Succinct is always better. Boussaid. Well, that is identical to part of what we wrote in the file, but you aren't wrong there. So, you remember who your husband is, right? SCP-351B Delta. Mike Landon Page. I would never forget. Boussaid. Alright, good. And do you also remember your marriage? You know, where you were at in the four... SCP-351B Delta. We were at the church at the end of the winding road leading into the woods. The sun was a shining ring of dashes, and the tree's leaves were thousands of swaying angle quotes that kept fluttering off. The wind was chilly. The clouds were puffy brackets. It was a beautiful day. Boussaid. Well, that's good to hear. SCP-351B Delta. Because of our involvement in the memetics division, the Foundation monitored the marriage and limited attendees to our co-workers, but it was beautiful all the same. Boussaid. Alright, good. Do you remember anything else about those clouds? The trees? SCP-351B Delta. The clouds were puffy brackets and the trees' leaves were thousands of swaying angle quotes that kept fluttering off. What else is there to say? Boussaid. I know you aren't one for talking, but isn't there anything more you could say? Even just a simple, I can't remember anything else. SCP-351B Delta. I can't remember anything else. Boussaid. Alright then. Can you remember how you felt then? Any of your emotions? SCP-351B Delta. I was happier than I had ever been my entire life. Every dash and letter of Mike Page's face filled me with joy. He kept making references to those bad Star Trek episodes we saw years back, and I couldn't stop laughing. At night when we lay back and stared at the asterisks in the sky, I felt like I was in love, all over again. Boussaid. Does remembering this make you happy? SCP-351B Delta. Yes. Boussaid. So, how come your tone of voice hasn't changed at all? How come your facial expressions haven't changed? No response. Boussaid. You say that this makes you happy, but I can't see it, Lucinde. I remember every day after that marriage, you couldn't help but grin if I even brought up the slightest thing on it, like how every dash and letter of Mike's face. Researcher Boussaid views the blank on his computer terminal, then resumes speaking. Boussaid. I'd bring up the slightest thing, and I'd keep seeing you smile for so long after. SCP-351B Delta slowly smiles. Boussaid. You're doing it now, but it's like when you copy what I say. It doesn't feel genuine. SCP-351B Delta. I was happier than I had ever been my entire life. Boussaid. But you keep repeating that. How I was happier than I had ever... This doesn't feel genuine, Lucin. I don't feel like I'm speaking to the real... to the real you. SCP-351B Delta. I'm myself, Ray. I don't get what you mean. Boussaid. I didn't want to tell you this earlier, since the clouds were puffy brackets and it was a beautiful day, but I think I should. SCP-351B Delta. It was beautiful, but what is it? Boussaid. Mike's dead. No response. Boussaid. He was in a containment breach several months after yours. He left a last message, but the agents never found his body. SCP-351B Delta. Oh. SCP-351B Delta's smile shifts into a frown. SCP-351B Delta. Oh God. How could this happen? Boussaid. That's the only reaction you can have? SCP-351B Delta. I am distraught. How could this happen? Oh God. Boussaid. I was laying back and staring at the asterisks in the sky, but this is all? Could you please, please think about the rest of your time with him? Can it get anything else out of you? SCP-351-B Delta. I don't understand what you mean. I loved him more than anyone else in the world. Boussade. But that's identical to what we wrote in the document when we wrote down how we were at the church at the end of the... Please, can you think of anything outside of what is in the document? Anything. Did the memories give you any mind past that? SCP-351-B Delta. I loved him more than anyone else in the world. Boussade. That's just what we wrote. It's word for word what we wrote. SCP-351-B Delta. He had such beautiful gray gradients of hashtags and ampersands in his eyes. I loved him more than anyone else in the world. Boussade. That's just... SCP-351-B Delta. I loved him more than anyone else in the world. Boussade. I loved him more than anyone else in the world. I'm sorry, Lucin. Researcher Boussade exits the observation chamber. SCP-351-B Delta continues to stare at the space Boussade was formerly in, frowning. No other movements are made. End log. In a state of emotional distress, researcher Boussade exited the chamber without viewing the blank on his computer terminal, breaching standard security protocols. This resulted in the mimetic spread of SCP-351-B Delta's memory constructs to all present Project Tinman personnel until site security was alerted and dispatched. Unusually, upon exposure to blank instances, the affected personnel experienced a near-complete loss of all memories regarding SCP-351-B Delta. The theorized cause of this is that the implanted SCP-351-A Delta memories were so similar to actual memories of SCP-351-B Delta that both became connected, causing the erasure of implanted memories to erase the actual ones. Since all acquaintances of SCP-351-B Delta had been recruited for Project Tinman and were present when Boussade breached protocol, all of the original memories SCP-351-A Delta had been based on are lost. Researcher Boussade has been removed from all SCP-351 related research, and new security protocols are being implemented to prevent the repeat of incidents of this nature. Project Tinman has been considered a failure. However, SCP-351-B Delta has proven useful in isolated environments that prevent mimetic spread. Following revisions to SCP-351-A Delta that removed information regarding emotions and added loyalty-increasing text, SCP-351-B Delta can consistently perform activities beneficial to mimetics research on a daily basis. Assuming plans for life support systems that will automatically provide health assistance to subjects are completed, SCP-351-B Delta is expected to be capable of serving the Foundation indefinitely. Item number, SCP-380. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. This object should be kept connected to a small computer in Health Lab H, in the off position. The object may be disconnected and moved to any computer that is capable of an internet connection, but by the request of Dr. should never be attached to a computer with internet access. Description. SCP-380 is a small blue box, with an appearance not unlike an internet router. It has a single antenna, a few lights, a power switch, and a single T3-line female connector. Although there is no plug for an outside source of electricity, SCP-380 will work when it is connected to a network-capable computer and the power switch in the on position. The device seems to be compatible with any computer it is connected to, hereafter referred to as SCP-381, and will open a large network connection. Low-performance computers are commonly unable to maintain said connection. Instead of wireless connections to other networked computers, however, the network is made up of biological entities within a 15-meter radius. Entities compatible with this network include but are not limited to humans, animals, and plants. As networked entities enter and leave the radius of connection, network connections are respectively formed and severed. Test subjects, and it is assumed all biological entities, are not aware that they are connected to a network. The only effect that is immediately obvious is the ability of SCP-381 to access biological components. When a biological component is accessed, it contains a single text document, readable by whichever operating system is utilized by SCP-381. Each text document contains variables, such as heart rate, stress, and blood glucose level, among various other physiological parameters, demonstrating accuracy surpassing that of modern technology. Experiment 381. Attempts to edit any of the text documents kept in organic files has responded with a message reading Error 271, data out of range, and the loss of any changes made to the file. Experiment 382. Normal health monitoring devices have shown the numbers reflected from organic files to be accurate, and therefore should be accepted as true. Requests to research SCP-380 as a potential health monitoring device are pending. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.